afternoon, South Africa, and a very warm welcome to you. This is Afternoon Express. My name is Jeannie Dean.
And I'm Bonnie Booley. Joining us in the loft today is a very special guest. I've known her since we were in our early 20s. We met on backstage. She's an actress, a dance choreographer, and an amazing mother. Her name is Lorsha Cooper.
Amazing. I'm so excited to have her in the loft today. And of course, she's brought her mini-me, really.
She's
her beautiful,
so
beautiful
cute
daughter. And we're going to be hearing the story about their beautiful relationship. Also, considering we're speaking a little bit about motherhood today, we've got the fantastic Kia Johnson in the loft. Now, for those of you who listen to Radio 2000, she is the voice of that radio station. And she is going to share her story about her miracle baby with us today as well.
Yeah.
So lovely.
Lots of inspiration. And speaking of inspiration, Danilo's in the kitchen.
It's always the food that inspires any great thought. Good afternoon, South Africa. My name is Danilo Acquisto, and joining me in the loft today is Megan Daniels, food stylist and chef. And the only way to start the show today is by going arriba, arriba. We're making nachos in the loft kitchen today, and I know we're not just crazy, we're making delicious food in the loft. So how are we going to put these nachos together?
We are going to do fully loaded nachos. So this isn't just any nacho. This is literally, it is stuffed.
Oh, I saw these and I thought maybe we could call it Taco Tuesday, but it's nachos, so it's just nacho. Oh, it's the first joke I ever made on Afternoon Express, I think.
It was.
What do you call cheese that you don't own? Nacho cheese! So all of that will be coming up on Afternoon Express. All the details are on our website, afternoonexpress.co.za. Get cooking later on with us, myself and Megan, in the loft kitchen. Let's start off the show, however, on the couch with the girls.
Oh, Danilo, I'm nacho friend. I love that. Our first guest today, Lorsha Cooper, is seriously one of the hottest actors on the scene at the moment, with roles on some of South Africa's best love television series.
She's also a professional dancer and a choreographer, and you may remember her showing off those skills in Backstage in the early 2000s, a screen she shared with Moa.
Yes!
This is like a big reunion. Us
I
on
know.
The same TV screen again.
I know, and it's so awesome to know the woman you are, Bonnie.
Wow.
I have to say that to you. I think, you know, so often as artists, the illusion of who we are becomes bigger than who we truly are. But you, I salute you.
Oh.
Just, it's amazing. I think that's what we were made for. I think that's our purpose, to be great reflections of God.
Wow.
Ultimately,
amazing.
That's what I strive for, and I recognize that in you. So thank you for your beautiful introduction of me. I thought I'd do the same right now.
Home
is amazing,
so
works in good and bad.
I know, right?
What a pleasure for women to be building themselves
Absolutely.
Up in this
right?
environment.
Each other.
How
yeah.
beautiful.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Mm.
So there we were, wide-eyed, excited, in Cape Town, making a show that South Africa had never seen, first of its kind. And you were a gorgeous dancer and actress, and you were able to actually showcase those two talents on one show.
100%.
What did that feel like?
Getting backstage, I think when I first heard about the auditions, I didn't want to go. Because I was like, I'm busy gigging, I was a full-time dancer, I was doing well. I had no concept of the idea that Backstage was this national show that, you know, people were going to tune in and you were going to become a known face. And so I got the part with no acting experience, no training. And when I got to set, I remember the first month I was on set learning the camera, learning the light. And one of the cameramen, Dave, said to me, "What are you doing?" And I was like, "Well, I have to know everything. Everyone else here knows everything." He's like, "No, my love, you must just know your lines and just deliver." So I think that has helped me so much in my career even now, because I don't feel like there's a limit to anything I do. I feel like if you don't grow, you're your only stagnation, you know? So for me, remembering that day always helps me to go, okay, so Lorsha, now you're in this, what's next? Now I've trained to direct, I direct multicam. And I'm
That's
like, it's
incredible.
Always, I'm always about, you know, our kids deserve to know that they don't have to stunt themselves in a world that says you should be one thing.
Yeah.
That saying of jack of all trades, master of none, it's rubbish.
Yeah.
I don't
but
believe in that.
But that's terrible advice for somebody to say to you, all you need to do is just learn your lines.
Well, learn
that's
my lines. Shocking
advice.
But because I was learning
but,
the
technical.
I mean,
technical. The advice you get on a set sometimes is the worst kind.
Yeah. But I was learning technical and I didn't need to learn technical.
But why shouldn't you? Don't you think as an actress, and I know as a TV presenter, if we understand how an editor's done, it makes you better at your work.
100%.
Absolutely.
But I think I was learning to act and do technical simultaneously.
Yeah. Okay.
Like, I didn't even know what hitting a mark was.
Yeah.
Now,
right,
I promise you, and that's like primary level. Like, that's the mark, hit the mark. And I was like, what does that mean?
Yeah.
What mark? Where's the mark?
You know, we were chatting earlier, and I love
mark?
I don't need the marks,
When we meet, we chat up a storm, and we just can't get the words out fast enough. But you were saying earlier that it was those years when everyone referred to you as a girl with the body. I mean, yes, you do have a banging body. It's absolutely insane. But you're saying a lot of people couldn't see past it and to see your gift. And you're on a show now where you play Tyson.
Yes.
And she's an inmate.
Yes.
And you're saying this is finally an opportunity for people to see a different side to Lorsha.
100%. The most interesting thing about being a woman with a body, as we all are, but a woman with a body, as if that defines how great you are. But in my world, it did. And so often I'd be told in auditions, well, you're not raw enough to play colored, your hair's too straight to play colored, you just don't look rough enough. So that box of being the pretty girl in heels with the calves was something that followed me for so long that when lockdown called me and they were like, listen, we want you to play this role, I knew that God had divinely intervened and gone, this is it. You know, because I also think success comes to you at a time when your character's ready, when you're a believer.
Yeah.
So for me, I knew that that was the time to have a voice and a narrative that was more, was about more than just me, more than just, oh, I'm playing Tyson. It was about breaking stereotypes. I think in our country, we suffer from that because even though we've progressed and we've transformed, there's still that stereotypical mindset that we stick to. And freedom for self is breaking that mold. So when they called me for lockdown, I was like, cool, let me eat. I literally started chowing everything I could find because I wanted to shift. I didn't care whether people were going to say, but she's put on weight. Her comeback is because I hadn't been on screen for 3.5 years.
Right.
I literally went like, even if they said I'm fat, I want my gift to speak louder than my external self. And I achieved it. I think lockdown's, for me, the best body of work I've done, playing someone completely and showing ability. You know, being pretty is not an ability.
But don't you think that comes with age? No, but don't you think that that realization comes with age? Because when you're younger, I think, and especially in this industry, it's very difficult for you to decide your value.
Yes.
Because everybody else is telling you what your value is. So you're the body and then you're the face.
Yeah.
And so you get told that that's what your value is. And then it's difficult to decide, well, will I be accepted and loved for other things as well? So that comes with age to be able to say, I'm confident enough to say I can do this and I'm going to take it on.
It does come with age because I think the word integrity is no longer just this word. It becomes an action. Yeah. You know, having integrity, turning down stuff that does limit you and not just looking for the bottom line to pay the bills,
you
know?
Yeah, because success is also about what you turn down.
Yes,
100%. Not just what you accept.
100%. Yeah, and so you have to also know, I was once told, well, take this job, it's a foot in the door. And I'm like, you know what, my God doesn't work with a foot in the door. He opens the door, I step in, and I'm there, I'm fully present. I don't need a foot in the door. So it's also, for me, your belief system. Like, what are your fundamentals, you know? What is your, what do you value? What do you carry? What do you want to say? I'm very purpose-driven, you know? I don't want my work to just be based on the fact that I'm famous and I earn a living off it. I wanted to be able to impact people's lives. So when I play a role like Tyson, for me, it's predominantly about there's someone out there and the story appeals to them. You know, not telling this typical colored stories, which are drugs, alcohol, cheating. It's all the really negative stories. Colored people get to tell those stories. And I'm like, no, I don't want to tell those stories.
I'm done with telling
those
stories.
I want to tell a romantic colored story. Well, we have that too. You know,
I want to have first world problems.
Right? Those nice problems.
No, I hear you.
I do think it comes with growing up. I think it helps to be a mom. But I do also believe that all of that trial is to have testimony.
Yeah.
When your intention is to be purposed in this world, when you want to be of service, you will have to have challenge. The nice thing about challenges is that you will have to have victory too. It's your choice. You know, you can either get lost in the challenge or you can go, well, I know I'm going to win this. I know this wave is here and I know how to ride a wave. So ride the wave and get out of it, get to the sand and be like, oh, the sun's so nice. Because that's what it is. That's life.
I love that. What a great message.
So incredible.
Thank you.
But you're not going anywhere. No. We've got more to chat about.
Yes.
And we meet Mini You.
Yay! Oh, my person.
So sweet.
Indeed, and we've got Mini Me right with me. Jenna, are you excited to go sit with Mommy on the couch later?
Yes, very.
This one's got a lot of attitude. Watch this.
That's coming up after the break.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express. We are back on the couch with the amazing Lorsha Cooper and her outstanding daughter, Jenna. How are you?
I'm good.
Welcome. Happy to have you with us. So you are 9 going on?
To 10.
Okay, I thought you were going to say 30.
Double digits.
I sometimes think that too.
Yeah, because I saw you present an award at the SAFTAs.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And how did that feel? Were you nervous? Were you shy?
No, I felt
because you were owning it.
I felt very, very scared at first, but then I felt excited and I was confident, so I just went for it.
Yeah, good for you. You know exactly what you want to do in your life, though. And I heard that you've got this answer all planned out for us. Yeah. What do you want to do when you're big in your career, in your life?
I either want to be a pilot, because there's not many female pilots, mm-hmm. A sketcher, and maybe an artist.
Wow. Okay, and how's your sketching and your art at the moment? Are you putting all of those things into practice now when you're young?
Yes.
Amazing. I know you're good.
And do you guys always coordinate your wardrobe? Because I know at the SAFTAs you both wore tutus and now you're wearing gin to gin and you've got blue nails.
So, I mean, you know, we kind of, when we do events or talk shows like yours, we try and kind of make an effort to have a synergy. And my thing is always, I like to keep Jenna a little girl, you know? Yes. She is that to me. So even though I wore this frock at the SAFTAs, she was still dressed in her floral dress. I think the dreams Jenna has, like being an artist, being all these things she wants to say, I believe they're all possible, you know?
Yeah.
It's like I said before, people limit us. And Jenna's incredibly gifted artistically, incredibly. She sings, she dances, she acts, she's just really gifted. And so for me, it's like have all those dreams because as a mom, I'm going to make sure that I nurture the things you love.
Yeah. Aww.
And that's how we drive the dream. It's one thing having a dream, but I think it's parents' responsibility to drive the dream. It's parents' responsibility to take care of that dream, you know?
I've got a cousin and she's got a little girl, similar age to Jenna. And we said to her, so what are you going to be when you're older? And she said, a professional cricket player.
Amazing.
And my aunt said, she's not going to kill that dream because mustn't be in her vocab.
Yeah.
Why can't I say to her, yes, you can be a professional cricket player because you're not a boy?
Yeah.
That mustn't be in a child's
vocab.
And
it's also important who we're becoming on the journey to our dream. I think that sometimes we focus too much on the actual dream and the tangibility of
and
it and less on who we're becoming in the process.
And what skill it gives us, what value it gives us. It drives who we become. Character is more important than what you'll ever do.
Exactly.
And becoming a mother, how has that changed you?
Oh, the most incredible, I often say, when I pray, I'm like, thank you, Father, that you decided to share such an incredible soul with me.
Yeah.
And so for me, when we talk about life-changing events in our lives, this was like complete direction-changing. I realized that for me, the most important thing was to be the most incredible example to Jay. I've always said, like, I'm position 1, 2, and 3 in role model, mm-hmm. and Oprah, Beyonce, all of them, they'll be behind me. But that takes an amount of work. I'd like for Jenna to look at me and realize that it doesn't matter where you come from. It matters where you're going, and it matters that you built on faith. It matters that you know, regardless of where you are, God has a plan, a divine plan for your life. The greatest thing I've ever taught Jenna was loving God and understanding that God loves her more than anyone ever could. So if you ask her who loves her the most, she'll say God. You know, so for me, that's always like an amazing thing. Changing me as a woman, I feel like my compassion for moms and women generally, it's just huge now, you know?
Yeah.
So it's just huge, and I understand that, like, you don't have a kind of book, a recipe book for how this is going to work out. So you just ultimately have the intention to do the best and to raise the most incredible human being.
And Jenna, are people aware of who your mom is? Are your friends and your peers aware of who your mom is? And do they talk about your mom? How do you handle it?
Most of my friends are aware, but not all of them. So they run to the car after school because they know that my mom's an awesome mom, not because they know that she's an actress.
Hey now! That's so amazing. And how do you feel when you watch your mom's work?
Well, I can't really, because it's 16, but I know when the when the trailer or the ad break or whatever comes on, it looks really good.
Do you know, I have a little boy, he's 7, and he once saw me in an ad for a series I was playing a detective, and I was holding a gun.
Yes.
Obviously, I didn't let him watch the show, but I was holding a gun in the ad, and he said to me, Mommy, Are you a bad girl?
Knowing me, I desperately wanted to say, hell yeah.
But I was like, no, baby, mommy's not a bad girl. I'm just acting. Yes. So sometimes it's hard for kids to understand.
Yes, and that appropriateness, I think, of age restriction. I mean, we're very strict with that, you know, because it's also about how social media and what kids are exposed to become their reality. And they start trying to live up to that, you know? So we're very strict on age restriction. And I mean, 3.5 years ago, you were what? Like 5.5? Yeah, 6.5. She wouldn't have been able to really conceptualize the fact that that's where I am. She wouldn't have been able to grasp it. So lockdown, she doesn't watch for obvious reasons. But yeah.
But you might be able to watch Zulu Wedding. You're in a movie coming out in September called Zulu Wedding.
Yes, I am. Yep. Yeah, which is awesome too. I mean, it was Dineo, our director. It's been a vision of hers for the longest time.
Absolutely.
And it comes out in September. And the nice thing about it is that it's a combination of American and South African talent, which is awesome. We also shoot beautifully to be able to, I think, capitalize on the fact that we live in such an awesome country.
Amazing.
You know? So it's really, really just such an awesome experience.
It looks so good.
It looks amazing. Yeah.
Brilliant.
Well, congratulations.
And it is. What was so nice about that was knowing, and I mean, as an artist, it's something so important for me to say, is knowing that we are no different and we are equally talented. It doesn't matter that we're in this country. I think also, we've been limited. We're as good as an American. We're as good as a British actor, you know? And that on that, I was like, can't tell the difference. Like, it's not like, I can see you from America and you're better than the South African. Yeah. No, it was an awesome experience to know that. And under brilliant direction, I mean, you can never go wrong with that, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for joining us today, ladies. We've loved
it's been
having
wonderful.
You.
Thank you.
Well, we're going to eat what you made in the kitchen.
Because I'm hungry.
What you're making.
Okay. I'm hungry. Making.
Okay, so we're crossing over to some social media because today in the loft, we're definitely chatting to two incredible mothers who are nailing what some people struggle with, you know, balancing career and motherhood as well. So we're asking you on Facebook, how do you give us some of your top tips on to balance parenthood and career? So let's have a look at what some of you have said. Bongani Mbokeni says, it's all about prioritizing. I'm no parent, but I can see how my mum is balancing between her career and my little brother. Then Young Prince says, time management helps a lot for you to balance your time, and you can choose to be there for your kids than going to work. All right, thank you so much, Young Prince. Over to you, Danilo.
There's been so much cool advice coming through on all of our social media sites, so keep it coming. If you are on Twitter, don't forget to use that hashtag AfternoonExpress. Now, later on, Jenna and myself are going to be making the delicious nachos, so make sure you guys stay tuned for that. And then later on in the show, we get a chat to Kia Johnson. Sit her down to find out more about her life as a mother balancing her work life. So you stay right where you are.
Welcome back. Thank you for joining us back on Afternoon Express live on SABC3. It's time for our hashtag Afternoon Explores series. Today, I continue my search for the ultimate form of yoga, a search that took me to the beach. Check it out. As you know, I've been on a quest to find the ultimate yoga experience, and I happened upon something called stand-up paddleboard yoga, which I'm going to try out this morning. And Bianca's going to tell us all about it. What is it, Bianca?
So stand-up paddleboard yoga is basically joining yoga and the world of stand-up paddleboarding. It's an awesome way to use your core and your balance and incorporating nature and just being out on the water, which we all love. Standing on a board uses all your stabilizer muscles, so the basic yoga moves, yoga poses, becomes a little bit more challenging, and it brings it right back to your fundamentals.
So I should expect to fall into the water a couple of times
today. I'm going to try my best to keep you on board. Also, the cold water is more incentive to stay on.
Okay, cool.
The board is obviously inflatable, and the actual mat on the board is made specifically for yoga. So everybody's got a paddle. Paddle faces this way. You have your handle on top, and your top hand is going to be on the top, bottom hand is going to be in the middle of the paddle. Awesome, let's get on the water. All of your stroke is going to happen from the nose till your feet. So we're gonna push down using our abs and obliques, okay? And your bottom hand is just gonna guide the paddle towards you. You wanna paddle as close as you can to the rail. You actually wanna hear a bit of a scrape on the side of the board. And if any time you feel a little unstable and you just want to not fall in, just get down onto your knees. Perfect. Okay, so closing your eyes, lifting your spine all the way to the crown of the head, taking your palms and facing them up to the sky to receive energy, bringing your hands into your heart center, sealing in your intention, gently blinking your eyes open and taking your arms wide up above your head, inhale. Exhale, bringing your hands into heart center. Taking it up to the center and taking the right hand to the right rail. Taking left arm, taking a slight half moon over to the side. So feeling a nice stretch in the left side body. Beautiful, taking both hands back behind you. Fingers facing forward, opening up the chest to the sky and letting the shoulders feel a little release and stretch. Coming to a neutral spine, taking the left hand, lifting it all the way up. Exhale, threading the needle underneath your right arm and coming onto the top of the left shoulder. Beautiful. Bringing the right hand a little bit up above you if you want a little bit more of a stretch. Inhale, coming forward. And we're gonna come into our first downward facing dog. So tucking the toes behind you and really spreading the fingers out wide, lifting the hips up high. And just feeling the heels go more towards the board, maybe pedaling out the feet. Then you're gonna come up halfway, inhale with a flat back, keeping your hands on the board if that helps. Exhale, forward folds. And just feel it out. So bunny, just take your one leg back. Beautiful. Taking it back a little bit further.
Wow, guys. Of all the yoga techniques that I've tried, that required the most focused intensity, but I absolutely loved it and I'm sure to do it again. And my best part of the class was lying on my board and feeling the water beneath my fingers and playing with the seaweed. I'm absolutely grateful. Namaste.
Look at a jaw.
How incredible. I know I made it look easy, but like the balance that you have to have,
it
and it works your core so hard. Yeah. I mean, there were a couple of times where I nearly fell off and I was convinced I was going to fall off, but it never happened.
Yeah. So I know Bianca, the instructor, and she's the most unbelievable.
Amazing.
Her body is just brilliant.
Yeah, she's incredible.
So that just shows what that yoga can do for everything. And so you're going to take it up and do it. Like
it was hard work. Like the slightest movement, you probably need like three positions like
never
that.
Never mind doing yoga on a supboard, but just standing up on the supboards, I was trying to paddle up a river. It's impossible. It's so hard
it's
to stay
hard.
Up. So I'm really, really
proud
of you.
But I was so excited. It was so much fun.
New summer hobbies.
Yeah. And you get to play with the water and you feel the seaweed touch your toes. It's so nice.
And no random people try and like jump in the water behind you and like disturb the peace, right?
No.
Crazy swimmers in the water.
Nothing like that.
Awesome. So I don't know how you guys manage to balance all of those things. I mean, it sounds like you guys. Balance, huh? Good one. Balance all of those things with work life, etc. But I mean, on Facebook, we're asking you guys the question, what sort of tips do you have for mothers in terms of trying to balance work life and the personal life? So Lena says, never be too busy for the ones that you love. I think that's one really good piece of advice, because they're going to be the ones that remain consistent, I guess. Boosie says, I was once asked when I'll become a parent, and I remember saying, I think I won't be able to handle everything. Thanks for the tips. Does one know when they're ready to become a parent, though? I guess that's a good question. It's like, when will you be ready? Dorcas says, I think if you can balance everything, you'll always manage everything. So try and find the balance.
The balance.
And I think it's really cool that you manage to, you know, try and do, you work really hard. I know how hard you do work, and we've always had these conversations.
Absolutely.
Plus, you're a mother. Plus, you're now trying out all these really cool ways to kind of center yourself. I think
absolutely,
it's a really, really cool way. You're living
And it's about taking it a day at a time. I always say, don't think about the week, don't think about the month, don't think about the year or the years to come. Just take it a day at a time.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, speaking of people who manage to balance their lives well, after the break, we continue our celebration of powerful mothers in the media industry and we sit down with Radio 2000's Kia Johnson. Don't go anywhere. A very warm welcome back to Afternoon Express as we celebrate powerful women who manage to balance lives in some ways that only superheroes can do. And our next guest can be heard as the co-host on Radio 2000's breakfast show, Planet Haibo. She was also a Goodwill Ambassador for the NGO Hope Cape Town. She's a mother, and some of you may remember her when she was still on Expresso Morning Show presenter.
Nou met jetpark op die R21 rigting noord. Ek sien Johan het ietsie daar so in die hoekie hierso en jetpark op die
Okay.
All right, my hat. All right. Woohoo. And breathe. All right, en jetpark op die R21 rigting noord die regte pad is toe en dis tussen die N12 Hoofweg Wisselaar en die Griffinsweg afdraai.
Talk about your days there, my word. To go from that into kind of coming back into a new story. Why do they like to prank you so much on that show?
I don't know what it is. I probably have that face, you know? People always say I've got this whole gullible thing about me. And Michael used to love doing it a lot. He would throw, like, peas at me and stuff. And I was like, what? People at the cupboard. That iguana, I'm telling you, I saw it in the corner of my eye. And I'm like, do not come close to me. And I see Yvonne is just, like, getting closer and closer and closer. It was hectic.
But I mean,
I think they're trying to, like, you know, elevate my stress levels or something.
I mean, how do they get from an iguana into a contortionist in a cupboard that just, like, pops out behind you? It's crazy.
You, exactly.
But why have you got a phobia of contortionists? I think that's more of a concern. Listen, Kia, I mean, that was a very fun side of how, like, sort of scary things can happen. I mean, but one real piece of scary advice or opinions that you got at a part in your life was where you found out that you potentially couldn't have children.
Yeah.
I mean, what exactly happened there? At what point in your life was that? I mean, what did that do to you?
You know, the funny thing was, is that I noticed for a very long time that I was just, you know, not feeling okay. Mm. A couple of symptoms that were happening at the time, and eventually I went to the doctor. Go to the doctor, he says, listen, I've got to do a scan, you know, like an ultrasound, and I'm like, okay. And I go back to him for the second appointment, and he actually discovers that I've got polyps inside.
Sure.
So obviously within your womb space. And he said to me straight, he was like, you won't be able to have kids.
And you were sure about that? It wasn't
that
maybe?
He was sure
or...
about that. And I said, there, and I remember I even cried, and he was like, what are you crying about? And I'm like, you just told me I can't have babies. And it's not like I wanted to have babies at that specific point in time, but at least to know that I have the choice. Mm. I mean, I cried by my dad's desk. I was working with him, you know, at you know, one of the radio stations at the time. And I used to sit by him, and I'm like, I just wanted to have that choice, Dad. That's all I wanted for about a year.
Sure.
Yeah. And then I got over that, and I kind of, like, you know, I forgot about it, and surprise!
So tell us about that first surprise of yours, that bundle of joy, and now you've obviously got two kids. I mean, it changes your life forever. I mean, this was a miracle in some way.
Definitely my miracle babies. My first one, my daughter Olga, I mean, she's just absolutely adorable. She's a bit big now, so she's telling me things,
such,
you know,
cutie.
Like, Mommy, you can't do that. But Mommy, but why does your cheeks look so red? Because I put on, like, a lot of blush the one day, and I was like, oh, my word.
They're so honest, eh?
Yeah, in your face. That's how you get it. And when I found out that I was pregnant with her, I think I was about 14 weeks at the time. And I promise you, it was this feeling of, like, oh my gosh, because obviously everything is running through my head. But the biggest thing was, I'm having this baby.
Absolutely. Did you ever go back to the doctor and say, well, hey man, how did this happen that I, you know,
wasn't able
to conceive?
Just not going to do that. Sure. I think I was just on this really great buzz, and I was just so excited and happy. It just shows you divine God intervention. You can't stop that.
Exactly. I love that.
Yeah.
Listen, a lot of mothers will say to you that you never really celebrate your parents until you've had your own kid yourself and realize what they went through. I mean, talk us through some of the changes that happen once somebody like yourself has children like this, and, you know, your life is completely different. It cannot be the same.
It is, yeah. Well, my dad likes to call it payback time. It's like, yeah, you see, when he sees me disciplining the kids, and he has a good laugh. But on a serious note, for me, it was just this unconditional love.
Mm.
You learn so much humility. I thought I knew not to be selfish. Mm. I thought I knew not to be arrogant. I considered myself a very kind person. When my children came about, it was like rock bottom, hard, unconditional love. That's it. It's as plain as it gets. You learn to respect other people more. You actually respect parents more. You see other parents in the supermarket and the kids are screaming and shouting and you actually go, shame, I feel sorry for them. And before, when I used to see parents like that, I used to go,
Why don't you discipline
your kids? What's wrong with you? Yeah. I promise you, I was in the supermarket the one day. I was actually in the aisles, you know, of the one supermarket. And Olga was just like kicking up this hissy fit. And I said, I'm putting you in timeout right now. And I put her right there in the middle of the aisle in timeout. Yeah, she did that face. Nice face.
Thanks very much. I was a kid one day.
She did that face and I was like, what? And I had these two omas come past and they were like, oh, you mustn't do that, eh? And I was like, excuse me.
Yeah, who are you? It must come with a lot of new factors. I mean, trying to consider the way society views mothers, trying to consider the way particularly South Africans view motherhood. It really is one of the toughest things to do, to go through. Because it's such a natural thing to you to have to look after this child. And there's so much to consider. I mean, you must always consistently feel incompetent in the process. But what a joy, you know?
It's an absolute joy, but I must admit that whole thing of, you know, you put your children first before you, it comes automatic.
Yeah.
It just comes, you know, you can't actually script that.
Exactly.
You don't get a manual, you just know exactly how it is and what you should be doing.
Yeah.
If they need you, you're running to their aid, you know, whatever you need to do to make sure that they're going to get better, you're there, because you're a mom.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Listen, on the show today, we're speaking about this balancing thing. I think you've done it so incredibly well. You've always been one of the hardest working people I know. And I mean, first of all, congratulations on your engagement. I think that's really awesome. Last year planning a wedding. Yeah. So you're having to manage that, you're having to manage having children, you're having to manage work, and you are now on this hectic fitness regime. Like, what's going on there?
You know what? I'm actually, I don't even know sometimes how I do it. And I must admit that there was a part of me where I actually went, how am I going to cope? What am I going to do? And I decided that routine is best.
Yes.
I've got a beautiful son as well. His name is Sebastian. He is so gorgeous. But he's almost 2 years old, so he's driving me up the wall at the moment. You know,
please give me his hair. I just want his hair. I just want it.
Gorgeous afro.
Yes. It's the cutest thing. I know. Oh my gosh.
And I find that that does help. The scheduling definitely does help. And obviously with that comes my fitness as well. I always call it a meeting with myself. So, you know, people go like, oh, I'm kind of meet up with you. I want to organize a meeting quickly. Yes. And I'll be like, sorry, got a meeting. Can't do that time. And there I go and I do my fitness.
Yeah.
Fitness at the end of the day, I must admit the first time, just after Olga, it was easy for me. I bounced back very quickly. But second time around, it has been so, so hard.
Yeah.
So I've had to stick to it. I've had to be consistent. I've had to have a good eating plan as well. And there are days when I feel like I just don't want to train.
Totally.
And I'm sure a lot of mothers can relate to that as well. I'm up at 4:30. I feel like I'm working night shift. Mm. I mean, I love my show, but it's those hours, you know, at the end of the day.
Yeah.
And I literally have to say to myself, you have to do this for you.
Mm. Sure.
This is for you. It's to make your body healthy so that you can be strong for your kids. The other problem I found as well is that I got a lot of back problems too. And people always say to me, but you're so thin. How can you have back problems? And
I'll
be like,
you
don't understand.
Yeah.
It comes with pregnancy. It comes with your body changing. Imagine you're pregnant and everything shifts.
Mm-hmm. All forward. The back has to compensate.
Organs moves and then eventually everything just goes like plops back again.
I honestly don't know how you've managed to balance all of these things, Kia. It's such an honor to have you on this couch with us. You are literally a super mom doing all that you do. Keep it up and keep inspiring young ladies and women out there to raise kids with all these different balances going on. You're looking amazing. I don't know how she thinks she's not managing to bounce back. Over to you, Bonnie.
Wow. Okay, so do you help mom out at home a lot when you're cooking?
Yes, I definitely do.
Oh, okay. You sound quite confident. So you're quite a pro in the kitchen.
Yes, I am.
Okay, indeed. So what do you think? I mean, do you think she's going to be good for this?
I think she's a triple threat. I think it's dancing, singing and cooking, right?
Yeah, and you had a dance move that you wanted to show me quickly.
Did I?
Yeah. It was so funny. We're going to take a short break, and when we come back, we're going to start all the yumminess in the kitchen, so don't go away.
A warm welcome back to Afternoon Express. It's a cha-cha kind of Tuesday on the show today. Joining us in the loft is obviously Jenna. Is going to be making us dinner. Jenna and dinner. And Megan Daniels, food stylist and chef. Also, girlfriend to our very own Clem Pendro. So foodie couples always stay together. That's what I've heard. So teach us your ways, oh master. What are we making?
Sure. So we're going to get it spicy in the kitchen today. We're doing Latin American style.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to do fully loaded nachos.
Okay, do you like cooking?
I love cooking.
Okay, do you want to take over the kitchen then?
I will indeed.
Right, what can we do?
Okay, if you can pass me the mince, please.
Which is the mince? Okay, there we go. You can pass it on like
good
a cool
start.
Train.
Okay.
So what are we going to be essentially making is like a chili con carne.
Oh, yum.
So instead of just having your nacho chips just on the outside and then just putting all your mince mixture and everything on top of it, we are filling tortilla chips with the mixture.
Oh, goody.
So when you bite into it, your mixture's inside. It's all absolutely delicious.
Delicious.
Okay, cool. So with that, can you pass me the beans?
You can go do this for me, Jenna.
Are these
there we go.
Beans?
So we've got black beans.
Yeah.
Thank you. So just in with that.
That's very traditional, right?
Here we go. And we've got some of the tomato and onion mixture.
This one?
You could do onions.
Oh, no, I think this is tomato
yes,
onion.
No, no, that's right.
Oh.
Here we go.
Yummy.
Sizzle. Going to start with a little bit of chili.
How do you
chili?
Do you like chili? Do you like your like sort of nachos?
I love chili. Chili
okay.
is the best.
So if you have like your best nachos ever, is it like got guacamole in it?
Yes.
Cream cheese.
Cheese.
What else is it like?
The
like
guacamole has to be on the side or either mixed inside.
All right, fancy. Okay.
You can see that the mince is starting to change color over here, and you can smell. It smells so good. Can you just pass me the salt and pepper, please?
That's this one over here.
Yes.
There you go.
So now do you want to just put a little bit of salt and pepper in here?
Just sprinkle it. No, no, don't use the whole thing.
Just like,
yowza.
And there we go. Perfect.
As your mom would say in the kitchen, Jenna, you always put the whole thing in.
Okay, so just for the purpose of TV, while this is going on, we've got a mixture that's done already.
Cool. Is that this one over here?
Over there, yeah, perfect. So these are our essentially our nacho chips.
Mm-hmm.
So what you're going to do is if we slice it like that.
Okay.
And then across this way. So you've literally cut it into quarters, right?
Yes.
So I'm going to give you.
Does your mom allow you to use a knife in the kitchen?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Parental guidance is advised. What? Is that the thing?
So you have to watch
We're the parents today. Cool.
Well, is she going to watch you, though?
Mom's watching. Watch those fingers. I'm watching you. There we go. You're doing well.
There. Perfect.
There we go.
Well done.
So
just split it like that.
There we go.
Cool. So these are obviously made up of corn, right? Or they're made out of flour. So you can
corn
kind of.
Tortillas.
Are they corn tortillas? Okay, cool.
I mean,
amazing.
You could make them yourselves. You could do it with masa flour.
Great.
But it's just so easy just to buy them like this. So what we're going to do is essentially fold them exactly like this. So you just place it on the side and then fold it over.
Yummy.
So that
is
your fold tortilla chip, basically.
So that's how that works. And then you kind of make a whole bunch of those, lay them in, and then they come out looking like that.
Exactly.
Cool. So how long do you leave them in the oven for? Because we've got our different
About
forms of cheese.
About 30 minutes, but this is just literally before we've done the cheese.
Okay.
So once this is all laid together, you chuck it into the oven, 30 minutes, leave it. That's when you've got your salsa music going and you're busy dancing around the kitchen. You bring it out, you put the cheese all over it so that it's literally gooey, melty.
Yummy.
Ooh.
So the first process is just when it's starting to kind of brown and get crispy, and then it's starting to melt. So we can fill a couple more of those. Let's see how you're doing with this.
Cool, so you can actually take some of this. So stop cutting now. You're not cutting. You're having too much fun with the knife. Jenna, typical. Okay, cool. Now fill one of these up for me. So you saw how she did that before, right?
So.
Cool, so you place a little bunch of it in the middle. More than that, come now. We're hungry in this love. You know your mom's gonna have to eat this. You're not even making her enough now. She's so upset. Okay, cool.
Perfect. Just fold it over.
Other way.
Oh. Up like that.
Yeah, like that. Yeah. There we go.
I love the sauce coming out of it.
It's great. It's all good.
Wow.
And then straight into here.
We like messiness in the kitchen. It's all about that realness.
Yeah,
all right.
Brilliant.
So you make a whole bunch of these. You place them in a dish. You sprinkle it across with all your favorite kinds of cheeses. Obviously, we've used the cheddar and a sort of mozzarella here, which you can use there. It'll all melt nice. Or white cheddar and a yellow cheddar, whatever you guys really want to do. Let that kind of cook in the oven for a whole bunch of time, and then.
If you can pass me that big bowl.
This
huge one.
A huge plate. Yes.
Dish.
Okay. Maybe I have to watch you in the kitchen.
Watch me. Do you want to put it down so we don't... Oh.
So here we go.
Oh, yummy. So you just kind of remove it out of the dish like that.
That is literally what it comes out of.
Delicious. And
so
I'm
this is an easy midnight...
I get to
midnight
smell.
What does it smell like?
Midweek as well.
Let's do the sneaky thing. Steal a piece of cheese.
Wait, but we have to finish it off first.
Sorry.
Okay. So here. Okay. Then I'm going to top it with some guacamole. She's going to do the salsa.
Oh, okay.
So the salsa over there with the spoon. Boop, boop. If you can pass her one of those spoons.
Then oh, yeah, the spoon's on the thing
spoon.
Here. Sorry. Gosh.
There we go.
Of course, the salsa goes on.
Salsa.
Oh, we've completely gone against your rule here. We're going on top, not on the inside or on the side.
And just for you, we're doing your favorite. We're doing some coriander on top.
Oh, fun. Decoration. Well, here you go, guys. You guys can go. You guys can
he
decorate
like
that in the meantime.
Very much.
All I know is that you can ask me the details for this recipe on our website, afternoonexpress.co.za. And seeing as we're going with this sort of vibe here, please say we can dance to the table.
Of course. That's
okay, teach me the salsa.
Okay, so we're going to stand like this.
Do you not have salsa yet?
I do.
She's a full dancer. Oh. So yes. Okay.
Let's do it.
So we go right together, and your hands just. Oh, there we go.
Okay, right together. Left. Okay, let me pick up the dish, and we'll keep going. I don't want to forget. Give me the dish. Give me the dish. Here we go. All right, let's go to the table. Right together, left together. Give us a round of applause. Come on, we're coming on. I can't dance to save my life, but we're doing okay. I'm doing okay. I'm just going to give up.
Thank you.
That was so yummy.
Now, this is a good dinner option.
Totally.
This is amazing.
Wow.
How yum. Anything with guacamole in it wins, right?
Yes.
Yeah,
cheese.
That's true.
But like, listen, it's such a different shape, though. I'm used to, like, this thing,
yes.
You know?
Dig in, guys, dig in.
Can I try pull one out and see how it
Break it up.
That'll
you want
be
to see
me,
this?
Definitely.
Yummy.
Ah, yeah.
There we go.
Yay.
Do you want some wax on top? Wow.
Nothing's on you.
Like, who else can I do something?
Don't be shy.
Don't be shy.
Watch me.
No,
It's good.
Yay!
Oh. Go, mama.
Steaming out your mouth.
I can just salsa out the kitchen now. My work is done.
Amazing.
Isn't that not your favorite dish from now on?
Oh, my jokes.
Thank you so much, our guests, for joining us today. We've absolutely loved having you.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you so much.
You are a legend. You're allowed back anytime.
Yeah. Thank you so much. We'll be back again tomorrow for our wonderful Wednesday cook-off. We'll see you then. Good night and happy eating.
Sumizis, Join the Afternoon Express cook-along tomorrow with Metro FM's Sumizi. Head over to afternoonexpress.co.za for the recipe and shopping list. Get all your ingredients together and cook along with us live at 4 p.m. on SABC3.
Another feel-good production.